The situation with climate change is clear. The crisis is not being managed in the way it needs to be managed at the moment. I am Sir Dave King. I have set up a climate crisis advisory group. The group represents the international experts on climate change to be available to the public, to policymakers, and to the media around the world. We need action now. What we as humanity do over the next 5 years will, in my view, determine the future of civilization.
Hello and welcome to this month's Climate Crisis Advisory Group public meeting. It's great to have you all with us for what marks 1 year since the creation of CCAG. And what a year it's been. The events of the last 12 months, from catastrophic heat waves and droughts to record high temperatures recorded in the Arctic, have all reinforced just how crucial the work being done is and exactly why we have to keep our feet firmly on the accelerator. Now, to commemorate the 1 year anniversary, and with the build-up to COP27 front of mind, we'll be doing things a little differently today. Over the past week, we have been reaching out to you, the public, to ask what you would like to hear from our experts. So with that in mind, please welcome Paula McMahon, civil engineer and patron of Climate Action North, Andy Corney, advocate of equality and climate justice, Shay Adebote, activist and host of Climate Talk podcast, and Ibrahim Mohammed Shamsuddin, co-founder of the Break Free from Plastic Awareness Initiative. Now, before I open the floor to our special guests, I'd like to invite our chair, Sir David King, to say a few words about the past year in climate science. Sir David, over to you.
Thank you very much, Addy. And I can be very quick. I'll just run through the current situation. The average atmospheric carbon dioxide levels have continued to rise. We have just hit 421 parts per million. And the carbon, the methane levels have been rising faster than ever before. This is the big worry, because methane is now a very significant contribution to global temperature rises, etc. If we then switch over to what we are particularly worried about, tipping points, we put out our big report at the end of August last year on the impact of the melting of ice in the Arctic Circle region on extreme weather events around the Northern Hemisphere, with an attribution for all of those events to what is happening in the Arctic Circle region. I've just had a message from one of our members, Tero Mustonen. Tero lives up on the permafrost in northern Finland, and where he is there on the permafrost, close to the North Pole, the temperature today, he's saying, is 32.5 degrees centigrade. That's plus 32.5 degrees centigrade, where the temperature would normally be minus 15 to minus 20. There's the nature of the crisis in the Arctic Circle region. And this is the first of the tipping points that is clearly tipping. More than 50% of the Arctic Ocean now exposed to sunlight during the three polar summer months means that all of the events we were talking about are happening. And since I've just heard this information from the Arctic Circle region, from Tero Mustonen, I have to say it's happening again this year, and it is even worse this year than last. So what we're looking at is a real crisis, and the question is going to be, how do we manage that crisis? The extreme weather events this year included unprecedented forest fires in the Pan-Arctic region, starting there, heat waves in India and Pakistan early this year, well before midsummer, recorded temperatures of over 50 degrees centigrade. catastrophic flooding in India and Bangladesh, March and April this year, and in Australia in February this year. Coral bleaching event bleached 60% of the corals in Australia's Great Barrier Reef in March this year. We are seeing an accumulation of extreme weather events. COP26 took place in Glasgow, November 2021. Some progress was made in ratcheting up the sense of urgency. I think for the first time we saw phrases like the climate crisis taking hold in the whole community during that discussion. But there were still serious failures, and in particular, the development of a lack of trust between developing and developed nations, because developed nations have not yet produced what they promised back in 2009, $100 billion a year to help the least developed countries and the developing countries. We hope that COP27 in Egypt is going to provide a way forward, and we certainly will have a presence there. Let me take you to some signs of a transition. Cleaner energy, well, we've got some good statements and reports, but we're not following through with actions. World Economic Forum in March reported that wind and solar generated energy were now more than 10% of electricity globally. More than 10% is a small fraction, given that these sources of energy for most of the world are now the cheapest form of energy installation available. If we then take the elections that have been happening around, of course, we all welcomed the result of the Australian election, the more climate-friendly government coming in than the previous incumbent. We would like to see this much strengthened. They have a pledge to reduce emissions by 43% below the 2005 levels, and that is an improvement, but we would like to see much more action there. Quite interesting, in South America, we've seen changes in government in Honduras, Chile, Peru, Ecuador, and in Costa Rica, once again, they've got a president who is committed to all the actions they've been taking. Costa Rica being the country one could single out as having done more on climate change than most of the others in the world. And of course, in October this year, we see elections in Brazil, and we're all very much hoping that we will see a turnaround in Brazil. If I could just then finally focus on the Ukraine-Russia conflict, we know that the reactions of some governments have been completely non-productive. So, for example, governments that are seeking new oil and gas sources around the world, new oil and gas sources, will not come into productivity if the work begins now for another 10 to 20 years. So it's a complete nonsense to give funding to the oil companies to make these discoveries. I say a complete nonsense. You'll be creating further stranded assets as the world understands we have to move rapidly away from fossil fuels. Very proud of the fact that that we have IEA member Christoph McGlade on this group, and Christoph is a major contributor to the IEA's 10-point plan for particularly Europe to manage the Ukraine crisis without selling out to the fossil fuel business. And also very pleased to note that the G7 heads of government just meeting this week made a clear statement supporting the IEA's 10-point plan, but also reiterated their statement, $100 billion a year will be funded within the next couple of years. We still need to see action, real action on that. And of course, we want to see public money. We don't believe that private funds should be counted in to this process. So I think one way or another, when we try to look at this in a positive sense, there is no understanding at the international level of the imminence of the crisis we're faced with, and what is happening in the Arctic Circle region doesn't stay there. But of course, it's also the first tipping point that will begin to tip the next tipping point, and away it goes. So we've got an enormous job of work to do. Thank you, Addy.
Thank you, Sir David, for that pretty alarming, but also comprehensive and those pertinent insights. If that doesn't open your eyes, I'm not sure what will. Now, to kick off our discussion, I'd like to head to Shay first. Shay, great to have you back with us again. Please give us your perspective on the climate successes and the setbacks over the last year.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Ade. And you know, it's always a pleasure being in this room with you, expert people that I really respect, and that, you know, it's always lovely for me to be in touch with you. So David made a lot of reference already to the question I wanted to ask, and I'm just going to put it straight. You talked about Brazil and a few Australia, but if we look at the African continent, from Congo to Kenya, Angola, and very soon in Nigeria, there will be presidential elections taking place. And you know, many of the conversations, the debates, manifestos, promises, all the propagandas we've seen, what I have seen is that the economics of biodiversity and the cost of environmental protection is least factored in all of this conversation. And it is really worrisome for me. So my question is this: how can we get politicians, policymakers, or those aspiring, or those even, you know, wanting to be reelected, how can we get this set of people to prioritize the subjects or conversations around environmental issues? It shouldn't be until they get elected. Right from the pre-election stages, how can we get them to prioritize conversation around climate change, environmental subjects? Thank you.
Great question, Shay. I just want to add to that. I was in Kenya last week, where they're about to have their elections as well. And I was doing a report on the farmers and the drought there. Kenya is about to go into its fourth season without rain. It's fourth rainy season where the rains have failed. The farmers are absolutely on their knees, struggling, running out of crops, and what crops they have left, they're literally coming into conflict with the wildlife. Elephants raiding their crops. This is an unsustainable crisis. It's absolutely awful. And I really agree with your question. It's such a pertinent question, Shay. Who can we throw this to out there? Who would like to take this one on first? Okay, we've got Professor Mark Maslin.
So I have to say, this is an incredibly important question because it goes to the heart of everything we do. It's about every country and how we move the whole dialogue forward, but also action. I actually think that we need to talk about things that matter to people and to politicians. So the first thing is health. We need to actually talk about health and why a safe environment, a clean environment, a pollution-free environment is good for people's health. Again, I'm part of the Lancet Countdown Commission, which publishes a report linking climate change and global health every year, strange enough, just before the COP meetings. And again, a lot of money in every country goes into the health services. So again, that's important. We also need to move the dialogue into sort of like talking about people's wealth. How do we actually produce enough electricity and energy to lift all those people out of energy poverty? Because all those countries we're talking about, there are millions of people that don't have enough energy. Do we do that with fossil fuels? Well, no. Why don't we do it with the cheapest and safest and secure energy sources, which is renewables? Then you don't have to worry about certain countries hiking the prices up of your energy and suddenly plunging lots of people into poverty. We can also talk about jobs, okay? Politicians love jobs. You know, the green economy is worth about $10 trillion around the world, but it's so dispersed that we can't actually see it, unlike the fossil fuel, the pumps at the stands for the cars. You can see that, but it's everywhere. So again, I think what we need to do is make sure that we clearly link environment, climate change to health, wealth, and job security. And that way politicians will get it and go, this is a vote winner. Hope that helps.
Thank you, Mark. So David, can you unmute yourself, please? Thank you.
My usual little problem. So I fully agree with Mark, but I just wanted to emphasize, actually, not all countries in Africa are backwards on climate change. Rwanda and Ethiopia in 2010 set out a green growth and climate resilience policy. In Rwanda, this was embedded in every department of government. And Rwanda was then highly successful in attracting funds from the agency sitting in South Korea, highly successful. And so they managed the transition process with funds from the fund that we're hoping will be $100 billion a year as we move forward in time. So what we need also is to acknowledge there is funding available, and it's going to become a much larger source of funds, and governments really need to focus on this importance. I'm not going to repeat anything that Mark said, but I do want to say there are exemplars in Africa, and other countries can really learn from the processes that happened there. Very, very important that these policies are embedded right across government. Right? It's not one department. It's not a Department of Environment that is simply going to handle this. It's got to be all departments, transport, energy, water provision, et cetera, all should be engaged in the process.
Thank you, Sir David. Would anyone else on our panel like to answer this one? Okay. Shay, what are your thoughts on those answers?
Well, it's always, I find it's always exciting when I hear Max speak. I love how we tied it to things that I could relate with, you know, as a Nigerian, having a clear knowledge of the African continent and politics and always trying to relate it to climate change. I totally agree with you. It would not make sense to go out there and say climate change is a problem if we cannot link it to jobs, if we cannot link it to the health of the people, if we cannot link it to wealth. So I totally agree with that. And I hope that in my own little capacity, I would see how I can chip in, you know, conversations around wealth, health, green jobs into political conversations and framework and tied to climate change. So I think that was really outstanding. And it's something I'll keep in mind. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Shay. We might have time for another question from you later on, but we'll move on swiftly now to Paula. You are from Climate Action Northeast, and could you tell us a little bit about what Climate Action Northeast do, and in your opinion, what was the progress on the climate last year?
Hi, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Climate Action North is a not-for-profit social enterprise set up to take action through exciting projects in the Northeast. We look to engage communities and win hearts and minds and provide opportunity to make a difference through a One Small Change programme, which helps the public understand that making one small change at a time will make a big difference and inspire and achieve climate action. I'm involved with them because I'm a patron, and also I'm the founding chair of Engineering Together, which brings together lots of different institutions and engineering institutions bodies to inspire young people into engineering, as to allow engineering to be more sustainable through a diverse workforce and having that sort of lens of climate action. We've made lots of positive actions in the northeast of England through inspiring young people and educating everybody. And I've also set up Primary Voices as well, which has actually saw over 8,500 students make climate pledges, and we've got 17 educators worldwide. I was very lucky to moderate a COP26 World Federation of Engineering Organization session on deploying global youth capacity. And also I championed a special issue of the Institution of Civil Engineers journal, The Proceedings on Climate Change Challenges. For me, I think that all of the groups that I'm involved in, the ones that I've mentioned and others that I'm not, are very much hoping that looking forward, that COP27 builds upon them promises that were made in COP26, and that we can actually see some measurable action and achievable plans. So shall I ask my question now, Addy?
Yeah, no, thank you very much, Paula. That was really interesting, and thank you for the work you do. But yeah, of course, go for it.
Yeah, so COP26 was, I believe, successful in bringing the issue of climate change to the public, and showing that there was sort of many possible solutions to reduce greenhouse gases, to be good for us all economically, health-wise, and every other way. But how do we keep up that momentum to get the message out to the public and keep them engaged?
Really, really good question. Important question as well. You know, keeping the public engaged in this and feeling empowered as well. Professor Lorraine Whitmarsh.
Yes, thank you very much for your question, Paula. I agree. Really, really important issue. And thank you for flagging the work that you're doing in the North as well. I think it's really exciting how much is going on at grassroots level and local level. I think one of the things that we've seen in the work that we do is that community groups, as well as local authorities as well, have a really good understanding of what local needs are, and they can sort of tailor climate solutions to that, to those local environments and those local needs. And I think part of my answer to the question, your question, goes back to the previous question, actually, which is that one of the best ways to engage people is to identify those sort of wider benefits of climate action. So to health, to wealth, et cetera, to things that people are really concerned about. And of course, in the UK and in many other countries, you know, we're really feeling the squeeze. We have this sort of cost of living crisis at the moment. And the latest polling is showing that while concern about climate change is as high as it has been for a long time, and we did have a peak last year for sure, but it hasn't come down very much this year. So it's still very high. And actually, there was a new international poll out yesterday by Yale University showing that in almost every country in the world, a significant majority of people is concerned and worried about climate change and believe that it is going to impact them personally. So I think that is kind of it is very much that the public is broadly on board with the need to tackle climate change. But in terms of actually sort of really engaging people with action and kind of support for significant transformation needed, it is about aligning messages with what people are concerned about. So highlighting the fact that actually taking action on climate change can, in some cases, save you money, it can be healthy, it can save you time, all of those kind of wider benefits. Now, in some cases where there aren't those wider benefits, what we absolutely need is policy action to enable people to make that change and make sure that those things are aligned so that it isn't more expensive to do something green or it isn't more inconvenient. So we absolutely need to have those policies in place that make those things even more aligned. But in the meantime, we can highlight that actually a lot of things that are good for the environment are good for us too. And one of the big headline messages from this year's IPCC report for me was that most of the things that we can do to mitigate climate change improve well-being for people too. So I think the more we can say that to people, it's not about sacrifice, it's actually about making you happier, then hopefully the more we can keep people engaged.
Thank you so much for that answer, Professor Lorraine Whitmarsh. I mean, while these live streams are a lot about talking to the governments, it's more importantly, it's about you, the public, and it's about how we can get you engaged and empower you and give you the knowledge. So thank you so much for that, Lorraine. Christoph, I saw you had your hand up as well.
Thanks very much, Ade, and thank you to Paula for the question. I really just want to emphasize some of the things that Lorraine already mentioned. COP26 was a success. It didn't achieve everything that it needed to, but it was a good step in the right direction. However, since COP26, we've had Russia's invasion of Ukraine, and this has changed things. We are now in probably the first ever global energy crisis, something that's never been seen before. And there is a big risk that governments and individuals will be distracted from the need to tackle the climate crisis because of this energy crisis. And one thing that we need to make very clear is that there are lots of efforts and initiatives that can help tackle both simultaneously. We don't need to choose between addressing the energy crisis and addressing the climate crisis. Individuals have a very important part to play, whether this is things like reducing thermostat temperatures, choosing not to drive where it's possible, choosing to work from home. Lots of things can reduce energy use, which will help reduce energy bills and will also help reduce our reliance on Russian energy. But a lot of those things can also help reduce emissions. But it's also up to governments. Governments have a key role to play because they underpin everything that individuals, communities, companies, investors, governments underpin all of that. So what we need to see is governments taking actions that are aligned with addressing the energy crisis and addressing the climate crisis. This is things like advancing renewables. Renewables, as Sir David mentioned, are the cheapest form of electricity in most countries now around the world. So accelerating the deployment of renewables will help reduce our reliance on Russian energy, and it will also help to reduce bills.
Thank you, Dr. Christoph McGlade. Mark, Professor Mark Maslin, I see you have your hand up as well.
So Paula, I have a really quick and radical suggestion because I think it's amazing you're working with young people trying to get them into engineering. So Richard Clark and I are trying to get a paper published, and it's not going well, where we suggest that engineers should actually have to take a Hippocratic oath. Because again, if you think about it, the built environment, building coal-fired power stations, there should be a point that actually professional organizations go, no, this is bad for local people, this is bad for people's health, and this is bad for sort of like the global climate. And so therefore, perhaps, like doctors, to do no harm, perhaps we should have engineers and maybe even architects taking those sort of oaths. Just a radical suggestion, just to spice this up.
I totally agree with you, Mark. I like it. Keep spicing it up. Excellent, excellent. Thank you. All of you are absolutely on form. I am going to move on to our next question just because I'm conscious of time. But thank you very much, Paula, for that, for your contribution and for your question. Hopefully, if we've got enough time at the end, if you've got another question, we can get one from you later on. But let's move on now to Andy. Andy Corney, welcome. And could you please introduce yourself?
Hi. Yeah, I'm Andy, obviously, as you just said. Thanks to everyone for doing what you're doing. It's something that the world just desperately needs. I suppose I'm sort of more radical than most in that I've sort of come to the conclusion, if we could spice it up a little bit further, where actually maybe money is the problem. You know, there's too much inequality. The money is just man-made. The climate crisis is also man-made. And that therein, the million-dollar question. And I suppose, really, I don't really want to know the answer to this, but I thought I'd ask the experts as you're here. And that is, how long do you estimate that the world has got, or the ecosystem has got, before its catastrophic collapse?
Wow. Wow. That come in with a heavy question for your first question.
Well, Andy, you know, it's sort of... I was just looking at some of the scientists I've been reading on Twitter and looking at that and thinking, okay, this isn't looking too good at the moment. Not enough seems to be happening. You know, how long do the experts think that we've got until the ecosystem starts collapsing around us? That's a key, I think it's a key question.
Yeah, it is. It is a key question, really important. We need to know how much time we've got. Sir David King, what are your thoughts on this?
Of course, this is an extraordinarily difficult question to answer, and I think you're expecting us to say that. because the collapse is going to have many, many different elements to it unless we can put an end to it. And that obviously is what we're all focused on. We don't want to see these things happening. But if we don't see the actions being taken that we all want to see taken globally, then what we could see as a rollout is mid-century, quite a big crisis in terms of rising sea levels, the number of people that will be underwater once a year, seawater, and the massive migration that will follow. For example, Vietnam is an extremely vulnerable country because it all lies very close to sea level, and by mid-century it could be flooded once a year. So what we're looking at is a series of catastrophes around the world. We're looking, for example, at India and Pakistan this year, where the temperatures in excess of 50 degrees centigrade for many, many people is not livable without air conditioning. And so with a reasonable humidity and temperatures of that kind, we can see massive challenges. I would take you to the end of the century and beyond to get to the point where if we haven't taken the required actions, we would see chaos. Of course, one of the factors is that as the global economy shrinks following the first series of catastrophes, we will see emissions dropping anyway. But nevertheless, not a pretty future, but we don't want to test the water on that future. We want to avoid it.
Exactly. Thank you so much for that, Sir David King. Perhaps Dr. Bob Carell, would you like to take a stab at this one? How long do you think our ecosystem has left if we keep going on at this rate? If you could unmute yourself.
There we go. There we are. I'm demuted. Thank you. I think the trend of this conversation is spot on, but I think we need to build partnerships with those who are going to be the action people, what we often call a co-production of knowledge, working together, get joint ownership of the problem. And we've been working on that on a number of fronts and with some success. The interesting thing is, for example, we've been working Congress people from the Republican side in the United States. And they've gotten the message. They've gone to the Arctic, for example, with us. What it's caused is that these people have been run out of office because they're on the other side. But I think in the long way, in the long term, when you can have joint ownership of the problem between those who are going to solve it and those of us who can bring the scientific knowledge to the table, in a way, I say the problem is sort of we are they. We have to be an organic part of the solution. And it's a real problem because, for example, we're not operating in the past. We can't. We got to be in what we are increasingly called post-normal, going into this new arena. So I think many of the trends here, for example, Mark's comments, if we could build joint ownership around the several topics he talked about. And I'm talking about the people who sit in positions of power to make a difference. And I agree with Sir David and others saying, you know, the problem is going to have to be worked at the governmental level. That's where the action is. That's where the control points are. And I think we should move in that direction. An example is we're having a lengthy conversation with the Atlantic Council because they got lots of people who are working the problem, but they don't have the connectivity to the climate community in a way. And we're talking about building those sort of things. So we can, my problem is I want to get us, the science world, the knowledge world, to co-partner with the people who actually are going to make a difference.
Thank you for that insight, Dr. Bob. But just also harping back to Andy's question, and it's kind of glib, but if we don't take the actions that you're talking about, how long does our ecosystem have left? How long do you think it has left?
But, you know, I guess you wanted me to answer it. I think a number of them are gone. Come on, look what's going on in Amazonia. If you haven't been down to Amazonia, go down there sometime, put your finger in the ground, and the length of your finger will be in sand. The length of your finger, it will be in sand. And that's because it was a desert at one time, and it's going back in that direction. So I think we're over the edge. Mm. Some of us don't believe that it's going to be possible for Amazonia to maintain itself because of the tremendous changes in the environmental conditions created by climate. I'd add one also thing. You know, one of our major partners in this enterprise is the press. And I think Sir David's made that clean and clear from the very beginning. That's a partnership we should develop more thoroughly so that when they talk about it, they make the connection. Too often they talk about it as an event,
yes,
but they don't make the connection back to why that event's occurring. And beautiful examples of that have been already discussed this morning. And we have got to build those connections so that, and that's why I want us to jointly own the problem with the people who have to do the job.
Totally agree with you, Dr. Bob, there in terms of connecting the dots and the job that people like myself in the press have to do. I'm going to move on swiftly, quickly to Dr. Christoph McGlade.
Thanks very much, Adi, and thanks, Andy. I wanted to give a slightly more positive, a hopeful message than your question perhaps.
Thank you.
Because I think we need to recognize we have come a long way. If we look back about 10 years ago, the anticipation when we projected things forward says we would be leading to a temperature rise by the end of the century of about 3.5 degrees. So emissions had been rising for the past century, and they were going to keep on rising. Because of the Paris Agreement, because of the radical changes we've seen in technologies, it's now unlikely that emissions are going to keep on rising going forwards. They're not going to fall on the basis of current policies, but they won't keep on rising. And so it's likely to be the case now that if governments have achieved what they've said they want to achieve, that we would have about a temperature rise of 2.5 degrees by the end of the century. So we've shaved 1 degree off just on the basis of what's been achieved and what's occurred in the last 10 years. Now, 2.5 degrees is still far, far, far too high. And it would lead to catastrophic changes everywhere. But also as part of COP26, lots of governments pledged to achieve net zero emissions, some in 2050, some in 2060, some earlier, some later. If all of those governments do what they said they are going to do, that would limit the temperature rise to 1.8 degrees. So from 2.6 to 1.8. Again, that's still too high. It's still not good enough. It's not the 1.5 degrees that the Paris Agreement has set out, but it is progress. And so what we need to make sure that we do is make sure that governments keep their commitments, make sure that they don't get let off the hook, that they see through, they accelerate and make their commitments more ambitious, and that they achieve them earlier than when they've set out. If we do that, there's a possibility that we can keep the temperature rise to 1.5 degrees. As everyone has been saying, that's still very high. That will still lead to catastrophic changes around the world, but it's certainly a lot better than thinking about the 3.5 degrees that was on the cards just a few years ago.
Thank you so much for that, Dr. Christoph McGlade. Really important answer there. And basically, we're giving you information and you should use that to hold your governments to account. Hold them to account. You know, make sure they carry out those actions because our planet depends on that. Professor Mark Maslin.
Thanks, Andy. I will be also incredibly positive, and I know that's not what you were looking for. I think that I'm going to build on what Christoph has said, which is we also have opportunities, okay? Because the third R in the CCAG is repair. So therefore, we have such agency as humans that we can actually repair ecosystems. We can start mass planting of trees, and we can re-wet wetlands, we can keep peatland. And I think that's where we need to start thinking about is large-scale repair of the ecosystems that we've already damaged, and actually think about it in a very different light. And I'll give you some really positive news, because the interesting thing is everybody worries about population growth, but most of that will be in the cities, and we'll get to about 10 billion people by 2050, and then it may stabilize and tail off. But they're moving to the city. So the strange thing is the world is becoming a wilder place. So there's so many places that we can start to repair, reforest. Remember, we've cut down 3 trillion trees. That's half the trees on the planet. So we know the planet can hold a lot of trees. So I think that's what we're going to focus on, is the third R of our group, which is repair, and actually see how can we actually repair the systems that we're already damaging, protect the ones that are still pristine and are under threat. And I think that's the positive way forward.
Thank you, Professor Mark Maslin and Christoph, for the positive ending. I see you're smiling there, Andy. What are your thoughts on those answers?
It's really good to hear some positivity, because obviously there has to be a great deal of climate anxiety out there. And I think quite rightly, there's no point in not worrying about this. We've had our head in the sand for so long. What really massively concerns me, I suppose, is that I don't see the actions from government that are really necessary. I don't see EV charging points going up everywhere. I don't see the change to economies. I don't see the levelling up that I think is, the levelling down. Let's face facts, we're so rich here in the West comparatively to the rest of the world. And I'm really, really concerned when I read reports about the sort of a billion people perhaps being climate refugees, and looking at the disgusting treatment of refugees currently. I worry about that. But I do have also this positive side to me that really, really hopes that our scientists can persuade the media in particular to really get on the case with this, because it is about telling the story so that everybody understands what's coming and what we have to do to ensure, you know, the survival of really literally most life on the planet. You know, otherwise we are absolutely snookered, for want of a ruder phrase. But it's good to hear some positivity, and yeah, I like the idea that we can use science to actually make the changes that we're going to have to make. And so I'm looking forward to seeing those come into the forum to a much, much greater extent. So thanks for those answers, and I'm positive as well. I wouldn't bother going on, you know, XR demonstrations and chanting really things that just make me feel so stupid, if I didn't think there was any point to it. So there's no point in being negative about this. We have to fight, and we have to fight, you know, for justice.
Thank you so much, Andy. Thank you.
You're welcome.
For that positivity, which we really needed. Okay, now moving over to Ibrahim. Thank you very much for joining our meeting today. So, Ibrahim, please tell us a little bit about yourself and your perspective on the climate crisis over the last year.
Well, I'm Ibrahim Mohammed Shamsuddin, and I'm from... Zaria, Nigeria. Over a series of experiences when it comes to issues around climate crisis, I happen to reside in a community where technically it's a grassroots marginalized community and a riverine area. And I've seen how people within such community battle with issues around flooding and the impacts of unsustainable or stable rainfall on their agricultural output, especially those into maize and cereal crops production. So I can say it's actually traumatizing seeing how people lost a lot of properties and livelihoods because of the climate crisis. So it's really traumatizing, especially with the people I've seen and I've conversed with. I have observed how they what they are going through. It's actually traumatizing.
Yes, I feel for you, Shay. I mean, for you, Ibrahim. It's what is going on in Africa is very, very, it's tough in terms of the climate change. And I also feel people in Africa are contributing the least to our carbon footprint out there and suffering the most. Can you give us your question, please? Question for our panel.
Yes, having said what I said earlier, I just have to take a look at our scenario in Africa, considering our urgent need for adaptation in response to the...
Oh, we seem to have lost you.
...starting climate crisis. Some of conversations around the loss and damage, financial loss and damage at COP26 is technically swept under the rug. And we fear similar might happen at COP27 in Egypt. I just want to find out, what will you say to us? Are there any ways forward in regards to that?
We lost you a little bit there, Ibrahim, but I'll just repeat the question, which is considering Africa's urgent need for adaptation in response to the disturbing climate crisis, some of us are concerned that the conversation around financing, loss and damage appear to have been swept under the rug at COP26. And we fear that the same may occur this year in Egypt. What would you say to Africans about this? Who would like to take that one on first? Basically, hope we need more hope from COP27. Lavinia, I see you have your hand up.
Thank you, Ade, and thank you for that great question. In relation to sort of adaptation finance, COP26 actually did contain a commitment to double adaptation finance. So I think in COP27, part of what needs to happen is to track whether that's on track. In relation to loss and damage, you're absolutely right. At least the issue of financing for loss and damage was sort of sidestepped at COP26, and it's certainly something that will come up and has come up in the subsidiary body meetings and will come up in COP27. I think that's a much more challenging question, deeply contentious sort of issue, has a long history in the process. So there's a limit to what we can achieve, I think, within the international climate change regime on that. I think on loss and damage, there might need to be small scale efforts in sort of court cases around the world, perhaps, which provide particular trigger and catalyze action at the state level, which then sort of bubbles up to the international level. There are also sort of cases in the pipeline, and attribution science has evolved quite dramatically in relation to indicating to what extent a particular weather event, extreme weather event, has been caused, or the chances of it has been enhanced or increased because of climate change. So there's more possibility for court cases on loss and damage to actually be successful. I would say at the international level, there's also sort of an initiative currently pending for the General Assembly to get enough votes to take an advisory opinion to the International Court of Justice. While that will not be specifically on loss and damage and compensation and liability, it will be at issue, the rights and responsibilities of states in relation to climate harms. So there is a possibility that we might get some direction from an international court or tribunal in relation to, you know, responsibilities for climate harms. So I think that's the extent to which we can expect something, I think, on this space, in this space.
Thank you, Professor Lavinia. Dr. Arunaba, what are your thoughts on loss and damage?
Thank you. Ibrahim, I want to answer your question in two ways in terms of, you know, what do we say to Africa? One, of course, echoing what Lavinia said, you know, the issue of loss and damage has been on the agenda of the climate negotiations since 2007. So a decade and a half later, basically what we got in COP26 was an agreement to have another dialogue on the financing of loss and damage. So that is problematic in and of itself, and Lavanya has very clearly highlighted some routes outside of the FCCC process that could move that conversation forward. But I think we have to say something else as well, which is that we need a deal for development. On one hand, what we see, and as is clearly evident, that the prices of renewable energy technologies are now significantly cheaper than the prices of fossil fuel technology for the energy source. We also know that 63% of the emerging markets across the world, including in Africa, not counting China, are already showing a pattern of peaking or plateauing in terms of the use of fossil fuels for electricity generation. So even without all the financing that was promised to them, emerging markets, including those in China, in Africa, are actually moving forward. But what is missing? We have three crises right now in the world. One is a fuel crisis. Second is a food crisis. And third, we have a finance crisis. Now, if we're talking about Africa, we're talking about South Asia, we're talking about Southeast Asia, South America, the question is, what is the deal for development that solves the fuel crisis, the food crisis, and the finance crisis? How is it all the things that Mark was saying right at the outset, the jobs that will get created, right, in these new sectors? How do we create an ecosystem that African countries are not just territories from where you extract critical minerals that go into high value added batteries that power our new energy system? Then the economic system hasn't changed at all. I've analyzed 36 technology transfer or clean energy initiatives over the past decade. Only 3 of them even think about actually doing anything in terms of technology transfer. I've analyzed 30 sustainable agriculture initiatives. Only 4 of them give the financing for actually transferring technologies associated with sustainable agriculture. So what we need for this deal for development is a paradigm on technology co-development, so that African countries or South Asian countries or Southeast Asian countries are not sitting and waiting for technology to be given to them because it ain't coming. But they are brought together on a platform where they co-develop the technologies and co-own the intellectual property. And that the financing actually flows where the sun shines the most. I can see that. I think it might be extremely hot where you're sitting, and you're doing exactly what I used to do, you know, fan myself with a book or a paper fan, right? And that is exactly the point. We are having this conversation as you are sitting in a position of energy deficit. And that energy deficit has to change to a position, not just that the fan runs in your home, but they are able to power an enterprise that delivers value and delivers jobs. Otherwise, we could potentially still have a significantly cleaner energy system and yet have an economic system that remains highly inequitable.
Yeah, absolutely. Really on point. Thank you so much for that answer, Dr. Arunaba. You know, I think equity has to be embedded in all our climate solutions. We've got about 5 minutes left. So we're going to go for one more question. And I think, Paula McMahon, you've got one more question for us to finish on a positive note, I think.
Yeah. So obviously, it's very easy to get embroiled in all the negative in the figure. I personally, whenever I sort of do get a little bit down, I look to groups like yourself to realise how much is getting done and how much progress is being made, despite the problems that we've got. So I'm wondering who on the panel wants to tell us what keeps them hopeful when they have a few dark days.
Love this question. Really, really good question, Paula. Who would like to take this one on first? Okay, we got Professor Laura.
Laura, thank you for the question. I think some of the things that remind me
why we're in this and that keep me positive is really some of the positive surprises that many people have mentioned already. Christopher mentioned this, Arunava mentioned it. And this is that, you know, there have been, you know, since the 2000s or 1990s, there had been a lot of efforts trying to understand where might we be with batteries, where might we be with solid state lighting, where might we be with offshore wind. You know, both in experts such as ourselves, as well as very detailed statistical models. And every single one of those forecasts in terms of where the cost of these technologies would be have actually proven to be pessimistic. So we've been actually gone faster than what everybody thought. And I think this is really the result of a combination of things. It's the result of course, some of the grassroots actions such as that you're engaged in, you know, that, you know, I've gone with my kids for the Fridays for Future demonstrations here in Cambridge. So that's very empowering. So we're seeing all of that. We're also seeing this wealth of policies. Again, you know, these things, that these policies that change the outlook from about 3.5 to, you know, 2.5, again, that Christoph was talking about. This was a range of things that I think people weren't expecting. So there has been some action. As the Committee of Climate Change just published yesterday in the UK, it's not enough to meet the net zero goals, but there has been some action. So I think it's some of these positive surprises and the energy of students. Certainly students are, you know, and what they know, what they are doing already and what they want to do, as well as some of these surprises definitely keep me positive.
Thank you, Professor Laura Diaz-Anadon. I'm going to pass it round to everyone, but please be brief. We've got 3 minutes. So let's go, Professor Lorraine Whitmarsh next. What keeps you positive?
Oh, you sprung that on me. I think my kids actually probably, they're so optimistic and they have I think they always have a positive outlook on life. So I think the fact that they have so much optimism is one of the things that keeps you going, as well as many of my colleagues and groups like this as well. I think we tend to look for all of those opportunities that we've heard a lot about. So yeah, I think that's what keeps me going.
Thank you, Professor Lorraine. Professor Lavanya Rajamani.
Thank you, Ade. Great question. Just quickly, two things. First, I've been involved in the climate negotiations for, you know, since the late 90s. And at the time, most people couldn't tell the difference between climate change and what the Montreal Protocol did, so ozone layer depletion. And in 2015, the Paris Agreement, there were 150 heads of states there. So there has been tremendous, you know, sort of upsurge in political salience of this issue, and we're beginning to see it have effect. And at every point when in the negotiations where we've thought, well, we couldn't possibly do this, this is not going to be within our reach, we've actually outperformed it in many respects. So while from the outside, it looks like these negotiations are moving at a glacial pace, actually there've been tremendous changes inside, tremendous adaptability, innovation, experimentation. So there is sort of, you know, a move to actually make things fit for purpose for, you know, resolving climate change. And the second thing I would say just very quickly is also my work with the IPCC and Working Group 3 report. While there were some sobering reflections in the Working Group 3 report, it also identified that in every sector, there are opportunities to halve emissions by 2030. So I think that's what we need to focus on. And we are finding solutions, I think, and that keeps us positive. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Listen, I know all of you are bursting to give us some positivity, but we are running out of time. So I'm going to end with Sir David King. Can you give us something that keeps you positive?
One of the things that keeps me positive has already been mentioned, which is young people. I do find that wherever I go and I'm talking about climate change, if the audience is young, the response is simply so remarkable. So we're in a very, very different world from where we were 25 years ago when I began to get heavily involved in all of this. And I suppose that positivity is what gives me hope, because it's the young people who are concerned about their own future. But that's not, of course, the only thing. Others have mentioned the progress that has been made. And one knows that emissions are still rising and that methane emissions have taken us by surprise. But nevertheless, we know as well that there are many avenues of success ahead of us. And so the final thing I would say that keeps me going is working on reducing greenhouse gas emissions deeply, rapidly, in an orderly and fair way. If that sounds like a big demand, frankly, we have to do it. And we have to see that the nations of the world pull themselves together on this issue. And I think the second thing, of course, is our second R, which is to remove the excess greenhouse gases already in the atmosphere. Critically important that we do that and do it quickly. And are we making progress? Yes. And are we forming large international consortia on this work? Yes, we are. And then finally, how do we repair the breaking bits of our climate system? And our particular focus is on the Arctic Circle. Well, of course, there's once again a large consortium, international consortium, working on this problem. So the other thing that gives me hope is that I can see the potential for progress. And while I sometimes sound rather negative and critical, I do want to say none of us will give up. We're going to battle all the way through until we have managed a safe planet for our future.
Thank you so much, Sir David. Thank you so much to all of our panel of experts and all of our guests for those amazing questions. What a session and what a way to mark our 1 year anniversary. A huge thank you once again to all our guests and as always to our CCAG scientists. And to those of you at home, thank you very much for tuning in. If you've got any questions for our panel, then please just send them straight over to through any of our social media channels. And we will see you next time at the CCAG public meeting. Remember, reduce, remove, repair. See you on Thursday, the 28th of July. Bye-bye.
The situation with climate change is clear. The crisis is not being managed in the way it needs to be managed at the moment. I am Sir Dave King. I have set up a climate crisis advisory group. The group represents the international experts on climate change to be available to the public, to policymakers, and to the media around the world. We need action now. What we as humanity do over the next 5 years will, in my view, determine the future of civilization.